Bible tells us that there were three gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and that Magi came out of the east and came to where the Christ child was. But the three kings are what we have surmised from those readings. But there is a legend. A legend of the fourth king. You see, the fourth king was to meet up with them. Melchor, Gaspar, and Balthazar. And the fourth king was Artaban. And he brought with him a large sapphire, a flawless ruby, and a lustrous pearl. Each of those were intended to be a gift to the Christ child also. But on his journey, he ran across a dying stranger on the road, a man who was there beaten. And he stopped and he helped this person by offering to pay his expenses with that large, beautiful sapphire. Then as he got closer to Jerusalem, he came across a mother with a male baby, subject to Herod's rule to be killed, as Herod was trying to eliminate all the competition. So Artaban used his flawless ruby to give resources to that family to run away and protect their child. He traveled for 33 years. All he had left was his lustrous pearl, until he ran into a young girl in Jerusalem whose family was deeply in debt and was in the process of being arrested and punished for their debt. Artaban used the lustrous pearl to pay their way, to pay their bills. And as he was leaving the house where the family was of the young girl, a piece of the roof fell, hit him in the head. I practiced this. And as he fell, dying to the ground. Artaban heard a voice. The Savior on the cross. And I have nothing to offer. And Christ said to him, "You've given it all." Good morning again, this wonderful Epiphany Sunday where we celebrate the coming of the kings. Oh, wait a minute. That's you. Yeah. Some of us dressed up, some of you dressed up, looking like kings before. Others of you came kings of now. Those who have brought their mighty gifts to the kingdom. The resources that God has given you, put into action to share the gospel message. I think that's all I needed to say. I could sit down, but I won't. Because this is a time when I get to share the good news with you. Because in the beginning of every year, we have this opportunity to look back and look forward, to reassess and to assess, to make decisions and change journeys, and go different ways, and go same ways, and think of ourselves as ambassadors of the kingdom. Feeling pumped up yet? I mean, that's what it's all about. New year, new ideas, new things, new directions. Oh my goodness. The blessings that lay ahead of us for this coming year. So the question that God encouraged me to ask to you, wait for it. What's the focus of your life? What is God calling you to do? What are you looking towards doing this year? It's a really important question, and sometimes it's really hard to answer that question. How do we decide the direction, the focus, the gifts? Let me give you an example. There's a large portion of the New Testament devoted to the journey of one person, the Apostle Paul, who had a direction, who had a focus. And on that special day, it all changed. He went a different way. It's about priorities in your life. And eventually, I think the eventually relates to every one of us. Eventually, our priorities come into order and the direction is clear. Almost as the kings saw the star and followed towards that destination. So the lectionary, where I normally choose what to preach on, was the one we enjoyed telling the story of the three kings and the legend of the fourth, if you got anything out of that one. But the message that is on my heart is more of a New Year's than it is reflecting and looking back. I'm going to share with you this morning from the message. I always tell you when I'm going to do that because it's a paraphrase. Poetic justice done to the good news of God's message. It is the third chapter, 7 through 14. The very credentials these people are waving around as something special, I'm tearing up and throwing out with the trash. Along with everything else I used to take credit for. And why? Because Christ, yes, all the things I once thought were so important are gone from my life. Compared to the high privilege of knowing Christ Jesus as my master firsthand, everything I once thought I had going for me is insignificant. I've dumped it all into the trash so that I could embrace Christ and be embraced by Him. I didn't want some petty inferior brand of righteousness that comes from keeping a list of rules when I could get that robust kind that comes from trusting Christ, God's righteousness. Experience His resurrection power, be partner in His sufferings, and go all the way with Him to death itself. If there was any way to get it on the resurrection from the dead, I wanted to do it. It's the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So, in your mind's eye, place yourself as the apostle. Before he was the apostle, before he was a Pharisee, before he was an adult, a child, a young boy in that time. And I'd say to you that Paul had three choices in his life. Some of those he had free will to accept, some of those things he, I don't know where that came from, some of those he chose on his own. But the three choices started off first with the desires of his family. Nothing but the best. The best schools, the best teachers, the best career path. His first choice made by his parents would be a little bit like somebody going to Harvard and graduating from Harvard and having the credentials from Harvard. Because you see that by the time Paul was a young adult, he had those credentials. Pharisee of Pharisees. Now the second of three choices that Paul made was his choice. It's like the Harvard graduate with a Juris Doctorate becoming the greatest lawyer of his community. You see, Paul graduated from the best teachers. Paul had all the resources that he needed to be the best of the best of Pharisees. He chose this avenue of success in his world because of the revenue and the resources of his family. And what did he see was the route that he was to take? He was to persecute the memory of Jesus, persecute the followers of the way, those who were Christians in the early world. And finally, his revelation, or possibly Paul's renovation. Who could be not who he was? We're living in a world of informational overload, relationship anorexia. The call of the church must be to know Christ, to make Christ known. Just say it in your mind's eye. Know, K-N-O-W, not N-O, K-N-O-W, know Jesus. That's the message of the kingdom. That's the message that we leave today with, K-N-O-W, Jesus. It allows us to have Christ in our life, to have direction. And it's different from the message that our society says, just say no, N-O. Say no to this, say no to that, say no to that. That's a different kind of no. What God's calling you to understand is the K-N-O-W-C-H-R-I-S-T. Know Christ. Consider who you were and where you were and what you were doing 10 years ago. But do that as if you knew what you know now. I heard this country and western song on the, it's really not country and western, I heard this country song on the way to church this morning that talked about if I knew ahead of time what I do know now, how different my life would be. Maybe you would say, I'm going to invest in this little startup company called NutraSweet. Maybe instead of taking French and Latin in high school, my daughter took 5 years of German, maybe you would have taken Russian or Chinese. Maybe you would have gotten married. Or not. Wait a minute, forget I said that. This is the wrong week to say that. Maybe you have enrolled in college and really hit the books as if it was important. Maybe you'd have dropped out of college and hit the road. Maybe you would have gone to more baseball games with your dad or with your son. Maybe you would have voted. All these might have done's don't count for anything today, do they? Because you made your choice. You focused on what was important. You took all of the things that God gave you, that your parents gave you, your inheritance of intellect, and desire and direction. And you chose. Sometimes it's not what you know, but when you know it. Sometimes it's who you know. Now, when I thought of that in the beginning, I'm thinking, when I say that, you're going to think, well, if I know the president of the bank, that's going to make life a lot easier for me. But here's what I was hoping and know that I knew. When I said to you, it's not what you know sometimes, it's who you know. In your mind's eye, in your heart, you go, he's talking about Jesus again. That the know, K-N-O-W, is about Jesus. And it gives us this powerhouse of knowledge way beyond the data that's circling our bodies all in this era of technology. So I found a story, hoping that your heart and your mind will put it together in a way that goes the aha moment. It was a story about a salesman from Rocky Springs, Montana. Now, I've never been to Rocky Springs, Montana, but it has a population of 25,000 people, which is not so different than Levy County. So this salesman from Rocky Springs, Montana, took an appointment to go to this small community. Because you see, he had spent his life, job after job, being fired or quitting before. Being a non-successful person, always looking for something different to become successful. And so this company was willing to give him that second chance that we talk about. We're going to give you a job that this time you can't mess up, because we're going to send you to Rocky Springs, Montana. I mean, who can get in trouble in Rocky Springs, Montana? That's what they were thinking. But the fact is that 5 years after that appointment, 5 years after he resettled his life and family in Rocky Springs, Montana, he was worth more than $30 million in insurance sales. He was worth more than $250,000 of personal wealth in his bank account. He had a private plane, he had his own landing strip, a yacht, a reputation, and one of the best salesmen in the entire country. From Rocky Springs, Montana, in a life that previously had been total failure. But don't get excited for him, because you know that every action has a reaction. Every choice has a consequence. Everything has two sides to it. And his success came with a price. He worked 75 hours a week, 52 weeks of the year. He spent all day Sunday getting ready for Monday. He lined up calls for the coming week. But the price was that his first marriage and children left him. He said he never sees his children anymore. He says, that's right, because they didn't see me when I was their dad at home. His second wife had now given him an ultimatum. Cut your 75 hours a week, just back to 60. Give us a moment. Or else. Sometimes you kind of feel sorry for him, right? He's only doing what he had never been able to do before. Now that he was successful, it was hard. Hard on the family, hard on his relationships. But here's what happened. He gained the world and lost his soul. Like this insurance salesperson,
There's a whole generation of exhausted, hard-working, well-meaning, but deluded men and women who are gluttonously stuffing themselves with knowledge and suffering from relational anorexia. We were in a restaurant the other night. Four people were sitting at the table. They all had their meals. They were kind of picking at it. Guess what they were doing? They were online on their cell phones. As if there was no one else in the room. They'd given up relationships for an internet connection. They know how to work, but they don't know how to be a friend. They know what it takes to get ahead, but they don't know a single person that they can count on if something goes awry. They know how to keep their heads above the water when life becomes overwhelming. They know how to make a living, but they don't know how to make a life. Paul had all the right knowledge, all the right connections to guarantee his success in life. And then suddenly Paul knew that he was completely lost when it came to the most important parts of this human life that we live. He had no connection with God, even though he was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was filled to the brim with knowledge and starving on the inside. Those who know Christ, generally know, can know Christ, are also those who cannot wait to make Christ known to others. Why do we think of Epiphany as more than the first Sunday of the new year? Many people don't. Many churches don't. But it is an explanation of a journey of giving and receiving more because you gave. I'm not talking about frankincense, gold, myrrh. I'm thinking that the gift that you give is yourself. And the gift that you receive is the kingdom. Many invest in possessions instead of treasures. Many trust only our heads and never our hearts. Many spend the contents of our wallets instead of extending the power of our hands. Many divide into factions instead of forming teams. Many fixate on what we want today instead of what our children need for tomorrow. You see, it's about focus. It's about looking where God wants us to be and looking where God wants us to be in the future. Possessions in this world do not replace knowing K-N-O-W, knowing Christ now and forever. You see, all of this and this is the treasure. Wow. I think I just got what I said. It's not about living. It's about giving. It's not about personal wealth. It's about knowing Jesus Christ. As all children say.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.